All right, wireless networks, let's talk about what they are, what they do, how they work, why we use them, why they're so cool, and all the different pieces of what makes wireless so awesome. So the first thing we're going to talk about, what makes wireless Ethernet different from wired Ethernet? What are the differences? You know a little bit about what wired Ethernet works, how it works, what the pieces are. How's wireless Ethernet different? What are the major protocols? What does it take to make a wireless network work? Let's get talking. First off, wireless networks use radio waves. May seem obvious, but maybe it wasn't to you. Same radio waves that are used to transmit your radio station to your car, at a different part of the electromagnetic spectrum, are the radio waves that make your internet work wirelessly. So here is a picture of the electromagnetic spectrum, and this is, a reminder from maybe back in the olden days, back when you took a physics class. You've got your visible light part of the spectrum here, ultraviolet, x-rays, gamma rays, all the way up at the top, infrared, thermal, microwaves, which is, the same microwaves that make your microwave work, and radio and TV waves, and those kinds of things. And right here in the middle section here, right in that lower end of the microwave spectrum, and at the very upper end of the radio spectrum are some bands of that electromagnetic spectrum that are free for you to use. And that's because they are unlicensed. And the whole reason that exists is because the FCC controls the airwaves. Now, that doesn't mean they're censoring the airwaves, although there may be some level of control there. But what it means is that the FCC in the United States determines who can use which of those bands of the electromagnetic spectrum. And it's good that there's that level of control, because if not, the airwaves would be so crowded with people, we'd have a tragedy of the commons situation. No one would be able to use it because everyone would be trying to use all of it all the time. So we have some control. And what that means is that the spectrum is divided into chunks by frequency. And at each point along that frequency, those bands can be sold to different companies. And some of those bands are left as what's called unlicensed bands, which means they are free to use. Free to use for everybody and everything. And what that means is that within those chunks of unlicensed bands, we have a lot of traffic. So those bands that I talked about, the 900 megahertz, the 2.4 gigahertz, the 5 gigahertz, and now there's a newly added 6 gigahertz unlicensed band. It doesn't mean it's the entirety of the 5 gigahertz. There's a small chunk of that that is unlicensed, meaning it's free, meaning it's busy. So for example, in the 2.4 gigahertz, you've got things like baby monitors, microwaves, your microwave oven that heats up your food operates at 2.4 gigahertz, which means that sometimes it's going to interfere. Your garage door opener might operate at 2.4 gigahertz. Your remote control car probably operates at 2.4 gigahertz. And having all this stuff operating in the same frequencies means that sometimes you've got interference between devices. Just like we talked about collisions in Ethernet, you've got essentially collisions in the airwaves because of multiple things operating at the same frequency. So for example, your microwave oven, if it is running, might cause interference on your Wi-Fi network. And if it's somewhere in between where your access point is and where you are, then your internet might break or your Wi-Fi might stop working when the microwave's running because of interference, because those waves run into each other, interfere with each other, and it breaks the ability to transmit data on that connection. So lots of interference because we've got lots of things operating at the same frequencies, especially here at this 2.4 gigahertz. 5 gigahertz is less crowded because there's a little bit more splitting up that we can do there. So we'll talk a little bit about that here. So Wi-Fi standards, there's a lot of them. They've been around for a long time. The original two Wi-Fi standards are 802.11a and 802.11b. So remember back in Ethernet, we talked about 802.3 is Ethernet's number in the IEEE standards. Well, 802.11 is Wi-Fi, wireless Ethernet's number. It's protocol number in the IEEE's stuff. And A and B are the first two standards. A was 54 megabits per second, so pretty quick. 5 gigahertz, so at that higher unlicensed band. And B was a little bit lower at 11 megabits per second at the 2.4 gigahertz band. So later on, G comes along And G gives us 54 megabits per second on that 2.4 gigahertz band. And then later N comes along at 600 megabits per second on the 2.4, and then adding support for the 5 gigahertz band. And that's kind of where we were at a few years ago. And then we had AC, and AC really kicked it up a notch. Now we've got over a gigabit per second, 2.4 and 5 gigahertz networks. And that's really awesome. And then they decided, you know what? We've had enough of this. A's and B's and letters and numbers and all this stuff. So you know what? We're gonna make another one. It's called 802.11ax. And because we've named so many things and numbered so many things and lettered so many things, we're just gonna call it Wi-Fi 6 because it's the sixth of these protocols. And then we don't have to keep making up ridiculous letters to keep track of all of these things. Users can finally have a simple number to remember, which is Wi-Fi 6. Now, theoretically, Wi-Fi 6 is pretty new. Theoretically, it can support up to 11 gigabits per second, which is pretty darn fast. It supports 2.4 and 5 gigahertz, and then Wi-Fi 6E, because, you know, why not add some letters to things, add support for this new unlicensed 6 gigahertz band in the wireless spectrum, which frees up even more. So again, the more we can move away from those super congested 2.4 gigahertz bands, the less interference we're going to get, the better everything's going to work. So the downsides of radio, we talked about this interference. The tricky thing, and one of the most amazing things about Wi-Fi to me, is that in Wi-Fi, only one thing can be talking at a time, because otherwise those radios interfere with each other. The signals interfere with each other. So when you've got 100 different devices that are all talking to the same access point, it's a bit of an oversimplification, but only one of them can be talking at a time. And as you're sending packets and things and receiving and downloading millions of packets and all of the or thousands of packets to get your data, only one of you is talking at any given moment, and you're trading off that time slot so that everybody can talk and everybody can download the images that they want or the videos or websites or whatever it is that you want. So awesome stuff. But unfortunately, interference means that only one thing can talk at a time. It's not quite as effective. And it also, because only one thing can talk at a time, you've got shared bandwidth. So when we say that it supports, you know, that 802.11g supports 54 megabits per second, that's 54 megabits per second total for all of the things that are connected to one access point. That's shared bandwidth, meaning that no one device is actually going to get that full thing, because first of all, that's a theoretical limit. But second of all, if you've got 20 different devices, that bandwidth is shared among 20 different devices. If you have 10 gig Ethernet plugged into your device or 1 gig Ethernet plugged into your device can use all of that 1 gigabit to talk at least within the local network, if not out to the internet, depending on your internet speed. You've also got the potential for security issues. And we'll talk a little bit about that in another video. But, you know, with radio waves, those radio waves are going out, and you can't stop somebody who's 20 meters away or 100 meters away from trying really hard, listening, and potentially eavesdropping on your conversation. Now, if you encrypt the conversation using the encryption protocols we'll talk about in another video, then you're limiting what they're able to get out of it. They can listen and they can hear that there are conversations going on, but they can't necessarily see what's being said, but they can see that there is conversation happening using antennas. And we'll talk about antennas in just a minute. And another important thing, another downside of using a radio, is that walls get in the way and other stuff gets in the way. There's this concept called attenuation, and attenuation is what happens to a radio signal when it goes through stuff. Whether that stuff is air or walls or chairs or people, there is attenuation that reduces the strength of a signal over time as it goes through things in distance. Now, you don't have to know all these numbers necessarily, but it's important to know that different things cause different levels of attenuation. And if you're in a cinder block building, that's going to cause some issues for your Wi-Fi signal. And so you're going to, you know, if your access point is three walls away, well, maybe your signal's not going to work super great. And worse than if you were three drywall walls away. So things to think about. You've got attenuation. Attenuation is a loss of signal in a Wi-Fi network, and it happens. So as far as what hardware you use, you're probably thinking that Wi-Fi works with something like this. And, you know, you're right, somewhat. We've talked about this before. We've talked about how this device right here is actually a whole bunch of different devices all in one. So it has a router, it has a switch. If it's got four Ethernet ports on the back, that's a switch. And it also has an access point. And each of these little plastic, upside down leg looking things is an antenna that makes your Wi-Fi work and boosts the signal and listens for responses and does all of those things. So that portion of this device is actually what's called an access point. And access points can look like this. They can also look like these. So here in my building, we've got access points that look like this, that are every, 100 feet along the halls and in each classroom. And you can look up in your classroom and probably see something that looks like that over there. And that is an access point, just like this thing, but without all the cool looking space looking technology. But inside it is still an antenna, radio antennas, probably multiple antennas to do what they need to do. Here's another one. Here's an example from Cisco. And here's an example of what we might call a directional antenna that is designed to send and receive in one specific direction. It looks a lot like a satellite dish because it kind of is a lot like a satellite dish. It points in a direction and it's really, really good at listening and transmitting in one direction and only one direction. If you stood behind that, you would probably not get any signal at all. But if you stood in front of it, you could maybe be 300 yards away and still get a signal. And the important thing to note there is that the antenna and the shape and the direction and the attributes of the antenna are what determines where signal is good, where signal is bad, and maybe how far signal goes. So most antennas that you see, things like this, that you see, that the space age looking ones in the special router that I showed, they are omnidirectional antennas. And the point of these antennas is that their signal more or less goes in all directions. They are equally capable of listening to broadcasts and sending out broadcasts in all directions all around them. And you might be able to move the antenna a little bit one way or another to slightly direct to the signal, but for the most part, it's going out in all directions. But not all antennas are like that. As our satellite dish example shows, there is also the Yagi or directional antenna. And some of these get really, really directional. Where here we've got an example, and you can look up pictures of it online, that has a whole bunch of little antennas all along here that are all pointed in the same direction. And the idea is that it's really, really good at pointing in one direction and picking up a signal from one direction. And here, this one down here looks like a rifle because it was mounted on a tripod and put a rifle scope on the top to be able to point in one direction to pick up a signal. And if you've got an antenna like this, you're picking up signals from hundreds or potentially thousands of meters away, depending on how good your antenna is and how good you are at pointing it at where you want it to go. And these kinds of antennas are really great when you've got signals that you want to point from maybe one building to another, where you don't want the signal necessarily going out all over the place, but want to be able to point it and direct it from one building to another to enable a Wi-Fi connection between two buildings. You can also build your own, and this is a popular one called a cantenna, and you're amplifying the ability of the radio to hear and transmit by putting it inside of this tin can amplifier that points and directs those things in one direction. And it does pretty much the same thing as what these things do, but with a tin can. So kind of cool if you really need to get a signal from one direction, and you know exactly which direction it is, look into building something like a cantenna or buying something like one of those Yagi antennas to get signal from one direction. So that's it for now. We'll talk about security in another video, but before we go, I want you to check yourself. What are the different types of Wi-Fi antenna patterns that we just barely finished talking about? And the next question, what are the downsides of using Wi-Fi? Obviously, there's lots of portability upsides, being able to walk around, being able to pick up a signal and not have to plug in, but there are downsides that come with that. What are they?